an intimate history.
Thursday night at 8 on NJTV. This is NJTV.
NJ Decides 2014, election night. Major funding is provided by New Jersey manufacturers, auto insurance, and more for New Jersey Business and Industry Association members and their employees. PSE&G, serving customers, strengthening the business community, and investing in New Jersey's future. The members of the New Jersey Education Association, making public schools great for every child. Barnabas Health, life is better, healthy, online at barnabashealth.org. Verizon, communication solutions designed for the people and businesses of New Jersey. Horizon Blue Cross and Blue Shield of New Jersey, an independent licensee of the Blue Cross and Blue Shield Association. New Jersey Association of Realtors, the voice for real estate in New Jersey. More information is online at njar.com. Wells Fargo, together we'll go far. The Star Ledger and NJ.com and the Independent College Fund of New Jersey in partnership with Investors Bank, serving our communities since 1926.
Good evening. I'm Mary Alice Williams. This is a special election edition of NJTV News. NJ Decides. We have an impressive panel of experts to give us their insights throughout this evening. Krista Jenkins is the executive director of the Fairleigh Dickinson University's PublicMind poll. Brigid Harrison is a political science and law professor at Montclair State University. Our Democratic strategist is Jamel Holley, mayor of Roselle, and our Republican strategist is Roger Bodman. I'm glad you're all with us tonight. The voters are sending United States Senator Cory Booker back to Washington to serve his first full term in the Senate. Here was the final vote with Booker gaining 56% of the vote over Jeff Bell's 42% of the vote. It was almost preordained from the beginning that Senator Booker would be reelected for his first time to a full term because the Republican Party gave virtually half-hearted support to Jeff Bell. Moments ago, Senator Booker claimed victory.
I want you to meet my son, the senator from New Jersey, Cory Booker.
Thank you, New Jersey! Thank you, New Jersey! I cannot tell you this. I know we got a lot of great folks in our country and even more great people here in New Jersey, but I dare to say this. I am the proudest boy in New Jersey right now. I'm proud to be a Jersey boy. I want to thank a whole bunch of folks real quick. First and foremost, I just want to thank my mom who introduced me. Her love and her nurturing with my father, who is with us now up in heaven, has been the mainstay of my entire life. And to have her and my brothers and my family here with me through these two elections has just been an incredible, incredible lift to me every single day. And I just want to give thanks to my family, starting with my mom. Thank you very much, Mom. And I want to thank Bob Menendez. You could not ask for a better friend, senior senator, mentor, and partner than Bob Menendez. He has set a pathway of service in this state that is recognized all around the country and all around the world. And like me, he believes that we are greater when we stand together. At a time that we're tired of Washington gridlock, he has been at the center of partnerships to help Jersey people out, whether it's issues like stopping flood insurance for New Jersey residents going up 1,000%, or the bigger cause for our country, which is the urgent need to pass bipartisan immigration reform. Bob Menendez has been pushing and getting it done. Thank you, Bob Menendez. And I want to thank the chairman of our party. He has been working up and down the state, fighting good battles. I even think he's going to have a big win in Bergen County tonight with Tedesco. I want to thank him for his love, for his work. For him, it's not about party. It's about values and ideals, and he's been representing it. Thank you, Chairman Curry. I gotta give a shout out real quick to my campaign manager, Brendan Gill, who himself running my campaign and running for freeholder at the same time. The man's got more jobs. Come on now. I have to say thank you for focusing on running the right kind of campaign, one that was positive, one that was energetic, one that unified people around our values and our ideals. Thank you, Brendan, for your hard work. Give him one more round of applause. And just two more thank yous. I want to thank every single person around this state who not just voted for me, but who also believed in me enough to work in this campaign, to give up your time and your sleep and your energy to pour it in so that we could have this victory today. This is a win that was earned by thousands across the state, and I give my gratitude. And finally, I just want to thank Jeff Bell. He is someone that has steadfastly, whether you agree with him or not, he has steadfastly put his energy into serving this country as he believed was right. He was a veteran and served in the United States military in Vietnam. And he is somebody that labored in this campaign with honor, and I'm grateful to have had him as my opponent, and I thank him tonight for all his kindness throughout this campaign.
Our David Cruz caught up with Senator Booker right after his victory speech, and here's what he had to say.
Senator, what do you do differently now that you've got a full six-year term ahead of you?
You know, look, we worked our hearts out this last year to really prove ourselves to New Jersey, let them know that whether they're South Jersey, North Jersey, we were going to be there. We were able to deliver some real things, whether it's for our veterans, whether it was for folks in Cumberland County facing foreclosure, or whether it's some big infrastructure investments and investments in our county college. So I just want New Jersey to know they got a workhorse. I'm going to double down even more so now. We learned a lot of lessons in this first year in the Senate about how to get things done, the highways and the byways, and so I'm looking forward to it. But the big pieces of legislation that we need to pass, from immigration reform all the way to things like criminal justice reform that are going to bring more justice, equity, and economic opportunity to our state, I'm going to get to work with my Republican colleagues and Democratic colleagues to get that done.
Does your approach change at all?
No, I think
you kind of kept your head down in the first.
I think I still want to make sure that I'm the workhorse for New Jersey, and that Senator Menendez and I are just bulldozers fighting it out to make sure we bring help, support, empowerment to our state. But you know, there are national problems that we have to focus on, and so we have to try to build a consensus sometimes on these issues. Like, most Americans don't realize that they spend $250 billion a year for a broken criminal justice system that's actually making us less safe. And we have 4% of the global population, but 25% of the globe's imprisoned people, and over 70% are nonviolent offenders. So these are things that I want to try to go out there and make sure people understand some of the pivotal pillars to getting us back to being an efficient government, a government that empowers its people and grows opportunity.
A Cory Booker fan said to me, Cory Booker, VP in 2016.
No, look, I know that talk, especially we've seen this, we've run this play in New Jersey before, when this talk starts about President, Vice President stuff. Look, that's distracting. People elected me to do a job. I'm going to give them six of the hardest working years of my life, and I'm rolling up my sleeves. I'm getting to work tomorrow.
So say no right now.
I'm saying no right now. I'm saying yes to New Jersey, no to anything else. I'm Jersey's senator, and I'm going to stay that way until 2020, when I'll come before the voters, God willing, and perhaps ask them for to rehire me.
All right, Senator Booker, thanks very much. Back to you guys in the studio.
Thanks, David. New Jerseyans around the state voted in 12 congressional districts to send representatives to Washington. Let's look at the boards now. In the first congressional district, they voted to send Donald Norcross, the brother of Democratic power broker George Norcross, to the Senate. That was an open seat that to Congress, forgive me. That was an open seat made open because Democratic Representative Rob Andrews had retired. It's been a Democratic district for 39 years now. In the second congressional district, Frank Lobiondo is going to be sent back to Washington. He has been there since 1995. His opponent, Bill Hughes, was the son of the man who'd held the office for 20 years before Frank Lobiondo had it. But Lobiondo has now won. So that area from Atlantic and Cape May, Cumberland, and Salem counties is the biggest congressional district in the state. In District 3, the voters have decided Tom MacArthur will be going to Washington. This was another open seat made possible by the retirement of Representative John Runyon. This was the most expensive race, not just in the state, but in the nation. Tom MacArthur lending some $4 million of his own money to his campaign over Democrat Amy Belgard. In the 4th Congressional District, Chris Smith has been reelected. He is going to be sent to Congress from the 4th Congressional District, which was Burlington, Mercer, Monmouth, and Ocean counties. He's been the incumbent since 1981. In the 5th District, Scott Garrett versus Roy Show. We are calling Scott Garrett for this. He is being sent back. He's been the incumbent since 2003. Roy Show had never run for anything before. In the 6th District, Anthony Wilkinson versus Frank Pallone. Frank Pallone, of course, has represented the district since 1987 in Congress, and he'll be back. Going to the 7th Congressional District, Leonard Lance and Janice Kovac were running neck and neck. Leonard Lance has been the incumbent since 2009. This encompasses Hunterdon County, parts of Somerset, Morris, Union, and Warren counties. In the 8th Congressional District, Albio Sires has won this race decidedly over Jude Anthony Tiscornia. Sires has been the incumbent since 2006. In District 9, Deirdre Paul versus Bill Pascrell. Pascrell is going back to Congress. He's been the incumbent since 1997. In Congressional District 10, Yolanda Bentley versus Donald Payne Jr. Donald Payne Jr. was elected 2 years ago after his father's death, also named Donald Payne. Now he is going back to Congress. In District 11, Mark Dunack against Rodney Frelinghuysen. Frelinghuysen, also an incumbent, also being sent back. This will be his 20th year in Congress. And finally, to Congressional District 12, where two women, Alita Eck and Bonnie Watson Coleman, we are calling this race for Bonnie Watson Coleman. She is not only going to be the first woman to go back to be sent from New Jersey in 12 years to Congress, but she is the first African-American woman ever. She's standing with Brenda Flanagan right now. Brenda.
Mary Alice, I am indeed with Bonnie Watson Coleman. Congratulations. You have made history tonight.
It's amazing. This is an amazing experience. I'm so humbled by it and so excited about the opportunity to serve my community in this capacity.
You're breaking into the old boys club down there.
Yes, that's a good thing, right?
I think so.
Yeah, women should be there more.
A female.
Yes.
But tell me what this means in terms of what you're going to be doing, breaking that ceiling for African-American women.
Well, I'm going to go down there as a representative of the 12th Congressional District, and I'm going to address the issues that confront us all. You know, if we're elderly, it's Social Security and Medicare. If we're children, it's making sure that we have health care and we have public education. If it's the middle class, I want to make sure that we have strong unions and we have good jobs. So I'm going to go down there as a representative of them all. I'm also going to be looking out to make sure that where there is disparity, and where government has a role, that we address that disparity and eliminate those barriers for women and minorities.
Now, your colleague, Senator Shirley Turner, said that, you know, you cut your teeth in politics, and she said, you learned to stand up to the statehouse boys. You're going to head on down to Congress and stand up to John Boehner. That's going to be a tough Congress down there. It's a pretty skewed Republican right now in the House.
Well, you know, I'm going to stand up for the issues that I think are important, and I will speak out and advocate on behalf of those things that I think the people of the 12th Congressional District are expecting of us. I don't know about standing up to John Boehner or anybody. I see myself standing up for things that I believe in.
So tell me, what is it that you want to do, and what committees are you looking to serve on?
Well, I mean, I'd love to be on the Labor and Education or Education and Workforce Committee. I'd love to be on Energy and Commerce. But I will take any assignment that they give me and be able to work on some of the other issues in task forces and little small committees, subcommittees, things of that nature. So I'm just wanting to go down there and serve.
A little bit of an emotional issue here. Your dad used to ask you questions about politics. He was a groundbreaking African-American assemblyman. He had basically, you wrote his speeches, I heard you say one time. What would this mean to your dad right now?
I know my dad and my mother are looking down from heaven, and they're saying, she was prepared for this, and we're just glad that she's carrying on the family legacy of public service.
Well, thank you, and congratulations. The lady goes to Washington and makes history.
Thank you.
Thank you. Here we are reporting live from Trenton. Bonnie Watson-Coleman, back to you.
Brenda, Bonnie Watson-Coleman was elected in an open seat, made open by the retirement of Congressman Rush Holt. Now we're going to go to the 3rd Congressional District. Another open seat has been called. The Republican Tom MacArthur has won over Amy Belgard, and Lauren Wanko is standing by there. Lauren?
Thanks, Mary Alice. With Tom MacArthur, congratulations. A lot of excitement going on right now.
Yes, there is, Lauren. Thank you. Yeah, this room is having a good night.
How do you feel? I know it's been a long race, a long day. You even said in your victory speech, thank God it's over. How are you feeling?
Well, I feel relieved that it's over. I'm incredibly grateful to the people of this district for putting their confidence in me. And I'm ready to get to work.
Now, the lieutenant governor, when she introduced you, was talking about the fact that voters took a risk in essentially voting for you and a man who stood up for the issues that you talked about. You've been criticized by your opponents for your North Jersey roots and not being from the area. What's your response now, your message to those opponents?
Well, the voters are the ones who decide, and I'm here to serve the voters. And there's always going to be naysayers. I'm not here to talk to them tonight, but I'm grateful for the people putting their faith in me, and I'm going to serve them.
What's going to be your first issue to tackle as congressman?
Well, jobs. That's what I've said all through this campaign. We've got 25 million people either unemployed or underemployed, and it's a drag on the whole economy, and it's obviously terrible for them. So I want to see the federal government adopt policies that can help stimulate job creation, and that's what I'm going to focus on.
I want to talk a little bit about Superstorm Sandy, because we are here in Ocean County, very hard hit. Lots of folks still looking for much-needed financial aid. What's your plan of attack there?
Well, the people need to get the help that's already been promised to them. And if you go down to the shore areas along Ocean County, they're still in some cases in terrible shape. So we have to finish the work that's being done. I also think we've overlooked the fact that the second homes in this county, 80% of which are rented, is the backbone of our tourist economy. And we've got to help get these homes back up and running as well.
And how do you think we go about doing that?
Well, I think for one, I'm concerned about the flood insurance rules and some of the plans to make flood insurance rates unaffordable over time. And I've spoken about, I believe we need to do some reform there and make sure that we're not raising flood rates to a level that regular working people can't afford to live in their own homes.
Getting back to the race, what do you think was your best strategy in this campaign?
Well, I think building a good team was critically important, and I think knowing what I stood for. We tried not to follow critics down every dark hole they wanted to drag us down, and tried to stay focused on the issues, the economy, immigration, our place in the world, the joint base, and making sure it's kept important in this district and gets properly funded. Sandy, which you've mentioned, these are the things I focused on, and I think that's what voters wanted me to focus on.
Well, Tom, it looks like you've got a lot of people who want to celebrate with you tonight, so we're going to let you get back to that. But thank you for taking some time to talk to us, Mary Alice. We're going to toss it back to you in the studio.
Thank you very much, Lauren. Tom MacArthur, going from the 3rd congressional district. That was an open seat. There were 9 races in New Jersey where incumbents were running, and in every single case, incumbents were sent back to Congress. So let's talk with the panel about the power of the incumbency, starting with you, Roger.
Well, I worked for 2 members of Congress. One, the wonderful, beautiful, great, late Congresswoman Millicent Fenwick. I started my career as a driver in 1974 when I graduated from college. And she was a wonderful, wonderful lady, rest her soul. But when you work in a congressional office, I mean, you have caseworkers, you have franking privilege, which is the free mailing service, so you can send newsletters. If you're smart, you're out there with town hall meetings. You're back like Millicent was, Mrs. Fenwick, every weekend. I'd pick her up at the train in Trenton and take her into her district, which was then Somerset, Morris County. I later worked for another congressman, Jim Corder, who represented the then 13th district. Same thing. So if you do your job right and you have the staff there that works on the Social Security problems and all the issues that arise, it's not hard. But keep another thing in mind. These districts are drawn in New Jersey largely for Democrat and Republican. I served on a congressional redistricting commission, so once you got a safe seat, you got a safe seat.
So what you're talking about is gerrymandering. Bridget, can you speak to that?
Well, I think, Mary Alice, in addition to the 9 incumbents that we sent back to Congress, we sent 3 new members, but all of them were the identical party as the incumbents leaving office. Tom MacArthur in the 3rd, we also saw Bonnie Watson Coleman in the 12th, and of course Mr. Norcross down in the 1st. And I think what this indicates is that congressional map making that Roger is talking about is becoming increasingly sophisticated, and it's driving voters out of the process and making partisan politics, partisan politicians, and map makers in charge of our democracy.
Krista, you look at polls all the time. The polls tell us that people are fed up with Congress,
right,
and yet they always send their own congressman back.
Absolutely. So as you went through the list of the 12 districts and who won, you kept saying incumbent. And the reality is that I think the casual observer to American politics would look at these results and say, oh, everyone's happy with what they have. And they're not. There is just great disaffection out there for the political process. But it is a two-party duopoly, and so you're basically, forced to choose between these 2 sides, neither of which really are resonating with many people today. So I think it really is a story of disaffection rather than any kind of resounding victory for either side.
Jamel?
When you look at polls, and I've always said this, polls are really based upon emotions. And when you look at this nationally, as we're looking at the maps and how who's winning and who's not winning, it comes down to the fundamentals and the maps. And when you look at it nationally, you will see that Democrats were in fights in Republican territories with a low voter turnout that is unprecedented. But I think that this will all change come 2016 when you have a presidential candidate on the ballot. So the Republican incumbents or the Republican wins tonight, those gains will decrease come 2 years from now.
Maybe wishful thinking, but we'll give it to you.
But Mary Alice, I wanted to pick up on something that Krista said. The thing is that when we're looking at our members of Congress, lots of people may be satisfied with their own member, but part of the role of the House of Representatives is to look after the 711,000 people that are in their constituency. They're not charged with looking out for the good of the country. And so as we get a more ideological Congress because of that map making, so you have Republicans in safe seats and Democrats in safe seats, there's very little incentive for them to compromise. There's also very little way for them to moderate because they're in safe seats. So my congressman or my congresswoman is looking out for my interest, but the other 435 are looking out for their own constituents.
Is another part of it, Roger, the fact that back in the day when Millicent Fenwick was around, people in Washington who were sent to Washington actually lived there. They took their spouses and their children there, and they sat on the same bleachers and worshipped in the same pews and knew each other, and so they could work across the aisle, and these guys don't know each other.
Well, certainly that's a dynamic that's changed, not only there, but in the state legislature, certainly our state legislature, and I'm sure others as well, where the civility has been lost. But, you know, keep in mind, and Brigid is absolutely right, these congressional district redistricting processes are very different. New Jersey, we now use a commission. I served on it many years ago. You know, but many states just do it by way of state law. In other words, if the Democrats control the legislature and the governor, they draw a map that's wildly Democratic, or vice versa, if the Republicans do the same. So they draw maps that benefit themselves and their particular political party and their political interests. How do we get away from that? I don't know the answer.
Aren't we inveterate ticket splitters?
We are. And the other thing I think is interesting to kind of add to this discussion is we're talking about how almost preordained these results were because of redistricting and because of the safe districts. But look at the money that was spent in this election. I mean, tremendous sums of money.
$4 billion in the nation, and what, for many millions.
And the reality is that most people made up their minds a long time ago. There was a very small portion of the electorate who went into this election undecided. And that's where the money was spent. It was spent on a very, very small number of people who are not partisans and who really went into this unsure about whom to support.
I want to go to two ballot questions. There were questions on the ballot, and we were surprised to learn the other day that people tend not to, even people who go to the polls in a low voter turnout midterm election, very often don't vote on the ballot questions, principally because they haven't looked at them and feel that they're undereducated and don't vote. But we do have two really important ones. And the first one was on bail reform. The question would allow the courts, instead of mandatory bail, to order pretrial detention of a person in a criminal case. More broadly speaking, it would allow minor criminals who were really no threat to society to be out of prison even if they didn't have the money to post bail, and major bad guys who had a lot of money, they wouldn't allow to have bail. Did I get that right? And keep them in prison. There we go. Inarticulate, though, that was. That one, we did get that bail reform. The second question was on open spaces. Right now, 4% of the money that comes from corporate income tax revenues goes to preserve open spaces. The question is, should we add another 2%? So it would be 6% of corporate taxes, and that one passed as well. Mm-hmm. How important are these ballot questions?
Well, I mean, we've polled on this, and we found that the vast majority of people had heard very little about the issue. But despite that, when you asked them, would you be inclined to support it, they said yes. So these results don't necessarily surprise me. On the bail issue, it was kind of a no-brainer, though. I mean, it's a law and order issue. People are being asked, do you support keeping people off the streets who could potentially be, you know, violent? Well, I mean, the reality is that many people say yes. So, but at the same time, as you point out, many people often will get to the end of the ballot and simply move on because they haven't seen it before and they simply lack the information to really cast an informed vote. But given the outcome, I think it was entirely surprising based on poll results before.
We're going to go back to the boards for a minute and remind you that all 12 congressional districts, the races have been called except for one, so let's go through them rather quickly. In Congressional District 1, Donald Norcross beat the former Philadelphia Eagle, Gary Cobb. In Congressional District number 2, Frank Lobiondo, this is the biggest district, he is a very strong incumbent, beat Bill Hughes Jr., with 74% of precincts reporting. Congressional District 3, only 35.4% of precincts have reported, but we've called the race for Tom MacArthur over Amy Belgard in this open seat race. In the 4th Congressional District, Chris Smith is going to be sent back. We are calling this, even though 27.7% of precincts have reported, over Ruben Scolavino. In the 5th district, Scott Garrett is being sent back to Congress. His race against Roy Cho narrowed for a while there and looked like it was going to be neck and neck, but in the end, just in the last closing days, widened out. In the 6th congressional district, we have, this is the one that's not yet called. Only 2% of precincts are reported, so it's way too early to call. So we don't know if incumbent Frank Pallone will be sent back. In the 7th congressional district, Leonard Lance has beat Janice Kovach. We're going to the 8th congressional district, where Albie O'Sires, a strong incumbent, Sires, forgive me, has beat Jude Anthony Tiscornia. In the 9th Congressional District, Bill Pascrell is being sent back to Congress. He beat Deirdre Paul. In the 10th Congressional District, Donald Payne Jr. is being sent back. His race against Yolanda Dentley, Donald Payne Jr., the incumbent. And in the 11th Congressional District, Rodney Frelinghuysen, who has been a long-term incumbent, beat Mark Dunick. And in the 12th Congressional District, is sending the first African-American woman in the history of New Jersey politics to Congress. Bonnie Watson Coleman wins. Joining us now is Michael Aron, our senior political correspondent. Michael, what's your take so far?
Well, one race that we haven't talked about yet is the Bergen County executive race. And it's being reported that Kathy Donovan has lost, the incumbent, that Jim Tedesco has won. Kathy Donovan has been in elected office for about 30 years. This is an upset. It has ramifications for the 2017 race for governor. It gives the Democrats control of the most populous county in the state. The second thing that jumps out at me tonight is that Scott Garrett has really seems to be beating Roy Cho by a lot. 2 years ago, Garrett had only a token challenge from somebody named Adam Gusson, and he won 55-43, Garrett did. This time, we thought there might even be an upset here, but the margin was 41% of the vote in is 18 for Garrett over Cho. So a race that we got a little bit excited about 10 days ago never really seems to have materialized unless Democratic towns come in late tonight.
I want to take you back to the Kathy Donovan race for Bergen County Executive. We have some video of her right now.
I called Jim Tedesco and I wished him all the best. He won. And I said, I look forward to working with him in the next 2 months. And we agreed we'd have a smooth transition for the people of Bergen County. And I told him, enjoy the night. He won.
Kathy Donovan conceding defeat. Michael?
Interesting that Bergen County seems to have split its ticket. Garrett wins. Of course, his district also spreads into Passaic, Warren, and Sussex, but 70% of it is Bergen. And yet, Garrett doesn't carry Kathy Donovan to victory. Jim Tedesco, a Democrat, not that well known outside of the county, maybe inside he is. Big victory for people like Lou Stellato, the Bergen County Democratic chairman, Loretta Weinberg in Teaneck, and Paul Sarlo, and all the Bergen
Dems. Now, this is a brand new Democratic Party chairman in Bergen County. Is this a feather in his cap?
Yes, it is. He's not brand new. He's been there for a while. He replaced Joe Ferriero, who had ethical issues, but who was very powerful and very successful, and elected a Bergen County executive named Dennis McInerney for 2 terms. And then when his life went south, that's when the Republicans took back the county 4 years ago. And now the Democrats will take it over again for the next 4.
In the United States Senate race, Jeffrey Bell, the Republican candidate, has just conceded defeat. We've got that now.
He won an impressive victory. And I wish him the best in the next 6 years. When I started this, and it was a rather sudden decision back in late January, I compared it to jumping off a cliff. And I did have a bit of a soft landing by winning the primary, but now I've hit ground. And I really, despite having lost, I do not regret for a moment having made the race. I have nothing but the greatest admiration and respect for the people of New Jersey. They were much more willing to listen to my views than I think I expected or that most people expected. And although I didn't win the issue debate or the election, I do not regret for a minute having gotten into this race and getting my views across and attempting to win a U.S. Senate race.
Jeffrey Bell conceding defeat to United States Senator Cory Booker. Michael Hill has been with the Bell campaign. Michael?
Mary Alice, it seemed that it was a tough ride for Jeff Bell the entire way, even before the primary. He was up against a very formidable opponent in Cory Booker in terms of financing, in terms of popularity, and so forth. And Jeff Bell said that he had to fight the good fight. He was asked here after he gave the concession speech about what's it going to take for a Republican to win a Senate, U.S. Senate seat from New Jersey, and he said divine intervention. He smiled, he laughed a little bit, and so did some of the reporters. But he realizes just how tough it is in a state where Democrats outnumber Republican registered voters. But Jeff Bell said that for now, he's just going to take it easy. I asked him if he's going to run for office again. He seemed unsure and uncertain about that. And he said that he did fight the good fight, but he wishes Cory Booker well in the state of New Jersey as well. But the bottom line is that he was completely outspent. It's tough in New Jersey for those in the Republican Party trying to win a Senate seat here. And Jeff Bell's candidacy certainly seemed to signify exactly that. Mary Alice.
And then Roger, where he was.
Thank you very much, Michael. And joining me now is Mike Schneider. We're going to be... Mike Schneider, who is putting on his microphone.
Absolutely.
Mike, you have done this for years. What do you make of what's happened tonight?
There's a lot of winners out there, as there is every election night. One of the things that's fascinating, of course, is to see what impact our governor has had on those who have won and what that will mean for his future, what that will mean for our future. But for those who are hoping for a good night for the Republicans, this apparently is their night.
There were 36 Republican, there were 36 governor's races in the country tonight that were decided, many of them Republican, and many of those, Governor Christie, who spent a full third of his second term campaigning on their behalf, was out there. Does he have tails? Do we know that he has real coattails, that he had a real impact?
Well, he may have tails. The tails don't extend to the state next door, though. In Pennsylvania, despite his efforts to go in there to help Governor Corbett, that didn't turn out. Many have said that the governor could not have been helped anyway, that his candidacy was doomed within the first few months of his administration. So the governor could not help the governor of Pennsylvania. But if you take a look farther to the west, stretching all the way out to Colorado, it's quite possible, or down to South Carolina, where some people said, why is Governor Christie going to South Carolina? What on earth could the South Carolinians think about Governor Christie? Well, apparently, he must have gone over fairly well there because it looks like he's got his candidate into the governor's mansion.
Also, he expended, Governor Christie expended some political capital in states where there wasn't a very tough contest. For instance, in Iowa, Governor Terry Branson has been there forever. There was no question that he was going to win. And yet, Governor Christie was there a number of times.
You
Why do you
think that thing that,
that
you and
is?
I both know is the Iowa caucuses might have just made
oh,
him
that?
Think? It could be. Because who else in their right mind would not want to go to Iowa in January?
Actually, it's a lovely place
it
in
is.
January.
It's a little cold.
But beyond that, does he have the political capital? I mean, he's out there doing favors for a lot of people in the Republican Party. Mm. Are they going to be happy to return the favor if necessary come 2016?
Well, that's going to be a hard one to really figure out. On the basis of political loyalty, one would say, if you take a look at the votes that he apparently helped those others to attract. Because I think just before I came in here, it looked like the Republicans were either winning or ahead in 19 of those states. Good night for the Republican governors. And some would argue that perhaps those turnouts, because governors are frequently the head of the ticket, also has helped with some of the Senate races, because now it appears the U.S. Senate, somewhere in the neighborhood of 51 seats, will go to the Republican Party. If that can be attributed to his strong efforts, not only physically being in those states to help the candidates, but raising all of that record-setting money that he raised through the Republican Governors Association, then there's going to be a lot of gratitude.
Let me ask you to go through that state by state, the race in Florida.
Race in Florida was an interesting one because there you had a former governor who, Charlie Crist, who many thought he went from Republican, he went to independent, he went to Democrat. Many thought that he had a shot at coming back and taking out Rick Scott. And the famous debate that they had just a few weeks ago, Fangate, as we now know it to be, where the current governor refused to come out for a while because he claimed that Governor the former governor had a fan installed illegally. At any rate, one of the strangest debates in the history of debating. You know, the governor down there has managed to prevail, it appears, in a very tight race. But there were those who say that Charlie Crist may have cooked his own goose in this case. Chris Christie certainly may have had an impact in this, but Charlie Crist, turning Democrat but not wanting President Obama down there campaigning for him, might have done himself considerable harm in the process.
Let's go to the Republican governor, the governor's race in Wisconsin, which has just been called for Scott Walker, Republican.
That's a fascinating one because on a lot of different levels, one of which is that these two guys, Governor Christie and Governor Walker, they could end up knocking heads for the Republican presidential nomination.
Really?
Neither one is necessarily wallflower about this sort of thing. Governor Christie was out there just recently once again campaigning on behalf of Walker, and the Walker people, I'm not sure exactly what the internal politics of it was. They were almost saying, well, we didn't invite him, but if he wants to come, we'll be happy to host him. Maybe there was some bad blood. Maybe there was some competitiveness. Maybe they felt they didn't need him. Maybe they felt that he wasn't just sending the message they want. But Scott Walker's back in for the third election he's won in the past couple of years.
Mm-hmm. Connecticut.
Well, that was, you know, a challenging one as well. This one, it's not being called yet, right? As far as we know?
No, it has not been called yet.
You had this kind of, with the political advertising, those of us who live in this northern part of the state especially were exposed to that one. That's going to be, you know, we could wake up tomorrow morning and still not know precisely where this one goes.
That close.
Or what the governor's impact may or may not have been on it. I'm not sure he spent a heck of a lot of time in Connecticut. But, compared to New York, he spent a lot more time. He didn't deem it to get involved in the New York race for obvious reasons, it appears.
And the governors of Illinois.
The governors of Illinois. We have a graphic for that as well.
Pat Quinn.
There you go, Pat
Bruce
Quinn. Bruce Round. You know, Illinois is an interesting state because a lot of governors out there end up serving the people and then serving time in jail. And at this point, according to this, you like that, Jamel?
Yeah,
that's right. I only speak the truth, my friend.
What is this, Chicago?
Absolutely. Well, you know, it's been known to happen before. This will be an interesting one because, remember, it's the president's home state. And the governor's coattails, Illinois go over to the Republican side, one would think that the governor of our state, of our fair state, would have a lot to, can I use the word cavil?
Sure.
We'd have a lot to cavil about.
Let's bring in our other panelists, Jamel Holley and Roger Bodman, and talk about Governor Christie's effect on these races. What's your take, Roger? Jamel, whichever.
Well, I mean, let's take it back to last year when the governor ran for re-election against Barbara Bono. At that time, his political capital was tested with the New Jersey legislature. And this is about in-state. This is not about nationally. It's about in-state. He was a very popular governor. And he had the opportunity to gain control of both the Senate and the New Jersey legislature, which he didn't. So nationally looking at him, he's a great person to go out and campaign and raise money for, but his political capital I don't think is relevant here as it relates to the governors in these particular states. It has
and
a lot to do.
Roger's going to disagree with you.
I probably will disagree with that. I know
sure
it's a shock, my friend.
No,
listen, as you mentioned earlier, there are 36 gubernatorial races. 22 of them are Republicans that had to be defended, and only 14 Democrat races of the 36. Of those, RGA is fighting in 9 states where Obama won twice. The dynamic here is very different. You and I talked about this before we went on air. The dynamic of these gubernatorial races is very different. And I'll give you another little hint about why Christie is in Iowa so often. You say maybe Iowa caucuses, my friend, Mr. Mm-hmm. Schneider. You know, Governor Branstad wins by 20-plus points. You know, he's top of the ticket. You know, Joni Ernst, who is a 2 or 3 point race for the United States Senate underneath Governor Branstad, you know, it's proven that when a governor wins a race by that margin, 78% of the time brings in the Senate race that's below him. That, believe me, that was in Governor Christie's mind. You know, not just to hang out in Iowa because he wants to be there next year or the year after, it's to try to bring in a United States senator in that state. And a lot of other states, that's true. 80% of in the gubernatorial races, the governor's race is the top of the ticket. So, you know, he crisscrossed this country in the last days. I followed his plane literally. You know, you can do it on certain websites. You know, this guy was all over 19 states since last Wednesday night or Thursday morning. 40 stops, raised over $102 million. The last record was $76 million that Governor Haley Barbour raised for RGA when he was RGA chair. So
I think slightly differently than
But his term is coming to an end fairly soon. This is a one-year term.
Yes, it is. You know, but you know, you have to shine, and this is the year. 2014 was the year. A lot of these, all these races that I just talked about. You know, the 22 races that had to be defended. Not a lot of them were incumbents that were doing well. Now, obviously, Corbett did not do well, but you know, we picked up a number of races. It looks like Florida will win. It looks like Colorado, Mike, right?
And the Colorado plays into what you were saying, Roger,
Arkansas.
As well, because the Republican Senate candidate won there as well, mm-hmm. knocking off Senator Udall.
But let's talk about Massachusetts for a minute. Yeah. I mean, you know, I don't know if that race has been called, but Baker was doing very, very well in every pre-election poll. Every poll I saw, the last five of them had him up by 4 or 5 points. Massachusetts, bluest of blue. Governor Christie gets some credit for that $102
million. It comes down to the fundamentals and the maps. And right now, you know, it's a very, very low turnout, especially for Democrats fighting in these Republican territories. I think
this all changes.
I think this all changes in 2 years. I think the gains today will be losses in 2 years when you have a presidential.
One thing that we saw in the presidential race in 2008, again in 2000, say epic get out the vote. Mm-hmm. Operations from all the campaigns that we did not see this time.
It has a lot to do with the top of the ticket with the president. The presidential elections bring out a lot of folks, and the get out to vote effort is much more visible than it is in versus other years.
I think it has more to do with the fact that one CBS poll, and there have been a million of them, have the president of the United States with a favorable, unfavorable rating of 39 to 51. You know, and when you ask the ever-present question, the ever-important question, the right track, wrong track question, is we headed in the right direction in this country or the wrong direction? That poll said 27% were heading the right track, 66% wrong track.
Not that I want to mention Jamel's job for election. We had to point out that the congressional poll about satisfaction level with our members of Congress, the numbers were even worse than they were with the White House.
And the most recent poll that came out today that showed that a majority of just over 50% of people think that they don't like the Democrats, but something like 79% don't like the Republicans. So what are we talking about here in terms of real polls? Of frustration, certainly, on the part of the electorate.
Yeah, of course, on everybody. I mean, they are very unhappy with the bickering and what's going on in Washington. But, you know, and we talked about the brand problem. I think both parties have a branding problem, right? And I'll fully admit the Republicans have one. And you look at governors like Christie or John Kasich that takes on Medicaid expansion, for example. You know, an issue compassionate conservatism, or you look at Christie in New Jersey talking about drug treatment and alcohol treatment and not jail. I mean, Republicans, in my view, have to talk about those types of things to soften their edge and be fiscal conservatives.
Well, that strikes the very heart of the issue for me tonight, which is that the Republicans are doing so well tonight. A few years back, they had equally high aspirations. But tonight, we don't hear the two words that we kept hearing a couple of years back, Tea Party.
Right.
And how much has that shift?
I'll let Jamal get a word in here.
Reacted. How much of the Tea Party's either presence, lack thereof, or subservience has manifested itself in the numbers that we're seeing, the results we're seeing tonight?
I think the main Republican Party has ran away from them. I think that it's scared them, and I think that it's changed the course of their party that they were going into, and I think
No, I agree. That's a good thing, because you saw the quote-unquote establishment candidates win most of these primaries, and now they're winning the general election. You know, if you nominate someone that's way far left, they're not going to win a general election. If they're a crazy liberal, if they're crazy right-wing, they're not going to win one either.
Almost forces that. I'm going to stop this conversation for the moment and go to a special tape we have. We talked about Bonnie Watson Coleman, the first African-American to be elected to Congress, the first African-American woman, I should say, elected to Congress from the state of New Jersey. She's filling a seat in the 12th congressional district vacated by Democrat Rush Holt. And he sat down with our senior correspondent, Mike Schneider, yesterday.
Congressman, first of all, thank you for welcoming us in. Election day, and for the first time in a lot of years, you're not on the ballot. Do you have any second thoughts? Are you second guessing yourself at all?
About not standing for another term? No, not at all. I have no regrets, and I haven't had a moment of regret since last February. It's just time. You know, no No person should expect their representative to be there for life, and no representative should expect to be there for life.
How did you know it was time? Did it just suddenly come to you? Was there an opportunity that came your way? What?
No, I don't yet know what I'll be doing afterwards, although I don't intend to retire. No, it was just this understanding that when I realized that someday I was going to leave, and I wanted to leave under my own power, not be carried out or voted out. And then it was a fairly easy thought process to figure out when. And so I haven't had a moment's regret. I'm also pleased that I can leave this district, the constituents here, in good hands. There was a good primary to succeed me, and I think there's a very good candidate. I think Bonnie Watson Coleman will do a fine job as the representative of the people of the 12th District.
The first day that you walked into the Capitol as a new member of Congress, you know, was it like a Mr. Smith goes to Washington moment for you? What did you pinch yourself? What was it like for you?
You know, I had worked on Capitol Hill in sort of 20-year intervals. 20 years before I went to Congress, I had worked as a staff member. I had had what was called a Congressional Science Fellowship, mid-career scientists who are placed on Capitol Hill by their professional societies for a year. And 20 years before that, I had been a page, a messenger boy. And so I had some familiarity with the Congress and its procedures. I had followed politics and public policy my whole life. From the time I was, in seventh grade, I had my own subscription to the Washington Post. So although I'm a scientist by background and by profession, I've always had an interest in, how people get along and how we govern ourselves.
But there are those people who say in Congress, people don't get along. And as a result, the institution itself has suffered. Over the, 16 years?
That's right. Right?
16 years that you've been there. What's the biggest change?
I think people have their heels dug in on their positions, on their party positions. I think there is a lot more intransigence.
On both sides?
On both sides. I really do, the fact that the Congress, the House of Representatives, has been doing nothing has to be the fault of the Republican leadership, because this is a majority-led body. If the Speaker of the House wanted to bring legislation to the floor, he could do it anytime. But he has chosen not to. That's why so few bills have been brought up for votes, so few bills passed, so few laws enacted. But if you ask what I'm most proud of, and I see this now still as I call people on the phone or walk down the street, I've made some gains, I think, in restoring trust of people in their government. You know, the cynicism about government is dangerously high, and a self-governing country works only if you believe it does.
Friends, past and present, have told me about the vast difference in the ability of a member to do his or her job, depending upon whether his or her party is in power. If you and your fellow Democrats remain the majority party in the House, would you have been leaving anyway at this point?
Quite likely. It's hard to say. No, I decided it was time. As I said, no one should expect their representative to be there forever.
A lot of the polls right now are indicating there's a good chance that the Republicans may also well capture control of the Senate. Does that trouble you?
Well, I've served in the majority, I've served in the minority, I've served with a Democratic Democratic presidents, I've served with Republicans. I guess I prefer being the majority, but it's possible to get things done, even with different arrangements. I certainly believe much more strongly in the Democratic program. The idea of increasing opportunity for all people, for the middle class, rather than some sort of trickle-down economics that is intended to benefit the well-off and somehow that will indirectly benefit everybody else. That's not good economics. I believe in open access to education. I think that, there's a lot that I don't like about what the Republicans are doing now, and it's basically that they don't believe in government. They don't think that we can do things to help each other.
You still have that passion. It burns inside of you, and one can see it.
Yeah.
So what happens, you know, next January when you wake up and suddenly you're not there anymore? What do you do with all that energy?
Well, as I said, I don't intend to retire. When people say I'm retiring from Congress, I try politely to correct them. I'm stepping aside. I'm not standing for another term.
Will you run for another office?
But I obviously, as you point out, I care about politics. I feel this. I haven't sworn off politics or elective office, but I don't see myself heading for that now. I don't yet know what I'll be doing in January, but I'm going to try to keep working on the kinds of things that I've worked on in Congress.
Well, Congressman, we thank you for letting us come on in, and we thank you for your service, sir.
Thanks very much.
And Mike Schneider also spoke with retiring Congressman John Runyon, and that was also a fascinating interview, but very different than his reaction.
In one case, one is closing the door, it appears, on a political career, Mr. Runyon. Mr. Holt, it appears, has something else in mind, although he won't get specific about it and he won't even acknowledge it. Holt says he's got, as you can hear, a desire to continue to serve in some capacity. There are many who say that he has chosen this time to step aside, as he put it, to prepare to perhaps run for governor when Governor Christie steps aside, perhaps early. Some would speculate as well. In the case of Mr. Runyon, he was just making it clear that he was disgusted by the system. And not just with, you know, he's a Republican. He could have pointed the finger at the Democrats.
But
he's not doing that.
This is just congressional gridlock. He was tired of it.
Partially gridlock, but also just I think his own leadership disturbed him. He didn't like Ted Cruz closing down the government. What did that get us, as he put it? He wasn't happy with some of the things that Speaker Boehner wanted to do. He said Speaker Boehner wasn't necessarily popular in his own district, so why should he carry the Speaker's water? You know, the Republicans had to understand the needs of his district as well. And he was furious at the way his own party's leadership, Boehner and others included, took longer than he felt was appropriate to deliver Sandy aid to this state. Those things bothered him a lot. We got to remember, this guy, even with
a Republican governor.
Yep.
Delivering Sandy aid. What was that about?
Well, it's because they fought like crazy to try to get it. Governor Christie was down there aggressively going it after. All members of the Jersey delegation were there fighting for it. And some of we talked about Tea Party before, some members of the Tea Party were aggressively trying to cut that down, keep the number lower, to demonstrate perhaps that the numbers were embellished beyond belief. Runyon he was 14 years in the NFL. He was a star football player. He was used to preparing his game, going out there competing, respecting the adversary, having the results, and then moving on. And in Congress, I think he got a sense the game was a game that he was uncomfortable with.
Tonight, two things may happen. The Republicans may get control of the Senate as well as Congress, mm-hmm. and the Tea Party appears to have been marginalized to a degree. Mm-hmm. Is that going to change anything?
Yes and yes. All signs right now point to the Republicans having won control of the U.S. Senate. There were those who argue that had they not done so tonight, the Republican Party would have awakened tomorrow and found a civil war within them. And then the Tea Party would have been competing against the others saying, told you so. But what happened before this election day was that organized members of the Republican establishment, as some have called them, got out there early. They weren't waiting for the general election. They weren't waiting for candidates to be approved by the voters. They were going out and they were finding candidates to run in the primaries. They were backing them. They were preparing them. They were getting the best people they felt would represent the broad Republican Party interests. And that's why they got what they got.
Mike Schneider, thanks for being here. That wraps up our special coverage of the midterm elections here in New Jersey. I'm Mary Alice Williams. For all the panelists, our field reporters and crews, and all the men and women of NJTV News, thanks for being here. A new edition starts now.
Major funding for NJ Decides 2014 Election Night is provided by New Jersey Manufacturers, Auto Insurance and More for New Jersey Business and Industry Association members and their employees. PSE&G, serving customers, strengthening the business community, and investing in New Jersey's future. The members of the New Jersey Education Association, making public schools great for every child. Barnabas Health, life is better, healthy. Online at barnabashealth.org. Verizon, communication solutions designed for the people and businesses of New Jersey. Horizon Blue Cross and Blue Shield of New Jersey, an independent licensee of the Blue Cross and Blue Shield Association. New Jersey Association of Realtors, the voice for real estate in New Jersey. More information is online at njar.com. Wells Fargo, together we'll go far. The Star Ledger and NJ.com and the Independent College Fund of New Jersey in partnership with Investors Bank, serving our communities since 1926.
Arts, movies, music, and entertainment news daily. You'll find everything Jersey arts and entertainment coverage in the Star Ledger.
This is NJTV.
Good evening. I'm Mary Alice Williams. This is a special election edition of NJTV News. NJ Decides. We have an impressive panel of experts to give us their insights throughout this evening. Krista Jenkins is the executive director of Fairleigh Dickinson University's PublicMind poll. Brigid Harrison is a political science and law professor at Montclair State University. Our Democratic strategist is Jamel Holley, the mayor of Roselle, and our Republican strategist is Roger Bodman. The voters are sending United States Senator Cory Booker back to Washington to serve his first full term in the Senate. And we're going to be going to him in a moment. But first, what's your takeaway of what you've seen so far?
I think Booker has always had his finger on the pulse since the day he received the nomination to go ahead with the U.S. Senate seat way back when. And what he's done in the United States Senate is impressive. He's hit the ground running. He's worked with Republicans on the other side of the aisle. And true to his own testament, he's worked hard. It's very deserving for Cory tonight. And I think that Cory's ability to raise money and to galvanize individuals is going to go a long way for him moving forward with our presidential race coming up in 2 years. He's going to be a very good asset to our Democratic Party here in New Jersey as well as nationally.
Here's what the Senate board looked like tonight. At the end of the evening, once the race was called, and it was called fairly early, Cory Booker won resoundingly over Republican Jeff Bell. We are going now to David Cruz, who is standing by at Booker headquarters in Newark. David?
Good evening, Mary Alice. The music has died down. The room has virtually emptied. All the celebration is pretty much over in this room and moved to, I guess, maybe another room here or another room across the city. But Cory Booker, a big victory, not unexpected, but he talked a little bit about the economy and mentioned that that was a priority for him. And he also talked about bipartisanship. Just heard Jamel Holley talking about that a little bit. And the mayor, or the governor, the senator, said that that's going to be one of his priorities, is trying to instill a sense of bipartisanship. He said that the country has lost some of that, and he wants to return to that. I asked him in an interview afterwards if he was going to be approaching the job any differently now that he has 6 years to look forward to and not have to worry about elections. He said he's pretty much going to do the same thing. He kept his head down during the first year, and then he said that he's going to look around more for some opportunities to sponsor some legislation. But he said that 6 years is a good long time to start working on that. And I asked him about the growing rumor that he would be someone who might be considered for a vice presidential nod. And he poo-pooed that immediately. He said he's not talking about that. And I said, say no right now. And he said no right now to getting on anybody's ticket as a vice president.
David, he has crossed party lines, sponsored legislation with Rand Paul, as I recall, and some others. So he has tried to be bipartisan. But I'm wondering where this puts Senior Senator Robert Menendez. If the Republicans, as it appears, take control of the Senate, then he is no longer chair of the Senate Foreign Relations Committee.
He will not be the chair. He will lose some of his influence. And in fact, Democrats across the country are bemoaning the fact that they are going to be losing that influence. And Menendez didn't make any reference to that. He said it was a good night for New Jersey. He didn't really make much reference to how things were going across the country, but he is going to lose some influence. And Booker as well will lose some influence. But for Cory Booker, it's an opportunity for him to be outside of the spotlight, and maybe it gives him an opportunity to work some of those bipartisan angles that he says he wants to work.
Okay, thank you very much, David. Michael Hill has been covering the candidacy of Jeff Bell, the Republican candidate for Senate against Cory Booker. It was an uphill battle, not helped overarchingly by the Republican Party itself or the Republican Campaign Committee. Michael, what's your take on tonight?
Mary Alice, uphill is an understatement. Jeff Bell simply said that this was a very tough challenge going up against someone like Cory Booker, who was popular and very well financed. On the other hand, Jeff Bell ran a very frugal campaign, and you can see that here tonight. When reporters showed up here at the Marriott in Teaneck, they weren't even sure that this was the right place to be because there were no TVs here. There were no Bell campaign signs here. In fact, the four you see behind me, campaign workers came in a few minutes past 7:20, along with some of the children of Jeff Bell, and put up these four signs, Jeff Bell for Senate, behind me. So that's an indication of just how frugal this campaign was. We saw some supporters here, but frankly speaking, it seemed that more laptops of reporters outnumbered supporters that we saw here this evening. Jeff Bell acknowledged that this was an extremely tough battle to fight against someone like a Cory Booker, well-financed. He didn't get much support at all from the national party at all in this race going up against against Booker. In fact, a reporter here tonight asked Jeff Bell about what's it going to take for a Republican to win a Senate seat in New Jersey, and he simply said divine intervention. Tough fight here for Jeff Bell and perhaps for any Republican going up against Democrats here who outnumber Republicans in the state of New Jersey. So Mary Alice, a very tough battle for Jeff Bell. He knew that he had some long odds, and he simply said that he wishes Cory Booker well, and that it was just tough. It was just a tough race when you're out-financed the way that he was.
Okay, thank you very much, Michael Hill. Now we're going to go to one of the open seats that was won by Tom MacArthur. This was the most expensive in the state and arguably one of the nastiest. Lauren Wanko is standing by in Tom's River at his headquarters. Lauren?
Hi, Mary Alice. The room, actually, the Victory Party room, emptied out very quickly here today. They were very excited here tonight. Initially, early on in this race, it was expected that this was going to be much more competitive. They were calling it a serious fight, but that seemed to change getting closer to election day. As the polls indicated, most recent polls, that MacArthur had a 5-point lead over his Democratic opponent. So naturally, there wasn't a ton of surprise here. I think his folks really expected a win. Certainly something they got here tonight.
All right, thank you, Lauren. What is the, it was a very difficult race that he fought against Democrat Amy Bellegarde. Lauren mentioned polls. Were they accurate? Very often people say, ah, the polls, you can't believe them. Can you believe polls?
Absolutely. Generally speaking, polls are very accurate in predicting electoral outcomes. It's a little more difficult at midterm elections because you're always, it's a little more difficult to figure out who's going to be a likely voter in a midterm. It's historically low turnout, and there's a number of things that make it more more difficult. But generally speaking, I think polls are very trustworthy. When we look at, for example, the Booker and the Bell race, it looks like it's around a 14 percentage point spread. That's where all the polls had it going into this election. So I think that there's, you know, your viewers can take a good degree of confidence in any of the, assuming that the polls were done well, that there's a good amount of predictability in the kind of results that you see prior to Election Day.
Well, I think one of the things that we're looking at in this Booker-Bell race, though, is, I mean, why is there, with a Republican governor who is so popular throughout the country, Why are we looking at a 14-point spread when throughout the country Republicans are taking control of so many U.S. Senate seats, many of which were unanticipated? And, I mean, I guess, Mary Alice, the question for me is, why isn't a John Bramnick or a Kevin O'Toole or a Tom Kaine Jr. running for these seats when in Christie Whitman in 1990 won against a very powerful, very entrenched incumbent, got 47% of the vote, didn't win, mind you, but then went on to become the presumptive nominee of her party for governor. So why didn't any of these state legislators choose to run?
It's a great question, Brigid, that you bring up, that we do have powerful Republican politicians in this state. Roger, this one's yours. Why did Jeff Bell run? Was Booker just too difficult?
Is that the best they could
well,
do,
Well, I guess it was. But here, no, seriously, I mean, I'll be very blunt about it. I hate Senate races in New Jersey. And the reason I do is we haven't won one since 1972. And when you live, and you know, the Tom Kaines ran, and you're absolutely right, we, you know, in, with benefit of hindsight, it was always 2020, maybe one of those guys should have run, or some wonderful woman in the state legislature, or whatever, and would have had a better chance of winning this race, certainly, than Jeff Bell would have, and would have had support as well. Bell was, as I mentioned, you know, ran in 78, you know, defeated Cliff Case, the last Republican senator we did have, ran against Milson Fenwick, my old boss, in 82, didn't win a primary, but damaged her, and she was defeated by a guy named Frank Lautenberg, a newcomer. So there was some, you know, there was some resentment, candidly, of Jeff Bell, at least amongst party insiders. Now, you know, listen, it's a 2020 hindsight question, Bridget.
I don't buy that for a minute. You know, Roger, look at how well Steve Lonergan did last year. Mm-hmm. Steve Lonergan, who's viewed as relatively conservative, probably not the best candidate, running on a shortened calendar. And so it seems to me that this was a very unique opportunity that the Republican Party had to offer voters a viable choice, and for a politician to get their name out statewide,
well, that's
to raise
true.
Some
that,
money.
That is true. And I mean, listen, it was the reverse of 2006. That's what we're talking about outside here. I mean, you know, take 2006 when the Democrats won everything and when Tom Kaine last ran not Tom Kaine Jr., for the United States Senate and got defeated by Senator Menendez. Presumably, you know, if you had the crystal ball and it was polished nicely, it would have been a great year for somebody like that, or perhaps
a great candidate. He's a very attractive candidate as it relates to raising money and mobilizing people. John Bramnick's a good friend. He's a great Republican leader. He's very smart. No one's going to match up against Cory Booker.
I want to talk about where Democratic campaign funds went in this race. But first, let's talk about the woman we just sent to Congress. The first African-American woman in state's history is going to Congress. And Brenda Flanagan is with her, Bonnie Watson-Coleman.
Hi, Mary Alice. We are live here in Trenton. Bonnie has left the area, but you can hear Whitney Houston singing I'm Every Woman. And the party is still going on here, a bunch of happy partiers. This is a breaking barrier, making history kind of night. Bonnie Watson-Coleman, 69 years old, is going to be going to New Jersey as the first African-American woman going from New Jersey down to Congress. She is a progressive Democrat. She says she's going to work to preserve Social Security, Medicare. She's going to champion women's and minority issues, particularly equal pay for equal work. She's pro-choice. She is, according to Rush Holt, who decided not to seek re-election and endorse Watson-Coleman, she's a woman who really cares, a woman who gets it. And her colleague over in the legislature, Senator Turner, said that Bonnie Watson-Coleman learned to stand up to the boys in the legislature here. When she goes to Washington, she's going to stand up to John Boehner. Now, Watson-Coleman said about that, well, listen, this is not going to be an easy journey, and you're going to have to be with me in spirit. Just a little while ago, there was a rousing rendition of Every Praise. That's her favorite gospel song. She had a whole crowd up there on the stage singing with her. Her dad, John Watson, served in the assembly, taught his daughter about politics, and it's obviously a lesson she learned very well, Mary Alice.
Okay, Brenda, thank you very much. His historical vote tonight in District 12. In 2012, it was women who sent President Obama back to the White House for a second term. This time, Republicans have wooed them. Democrats have relied on them. But many tend not to vote in midterms. Brenda Flanagan puts a face on the gender gap.
A lot of people are just depressed with what's going on in the economy, period.
Deidre Bigger says it's tough out here, especially for women. She's a single mom in Newark who's struggling to keep faith with the Democrats.
Because everybody's saying they don't know who they want to vote for. We're all confused right now.
They made promises and they didn't keep the promises. You can't just make a promise to somebody and don't keep it.
In 2008, single women helped launch President Obama into the Oval Office. It's a voting bloc that still carries significant electoral weight. Recent polls show unmarried women favor Democrats by more than 20% over Republicans nationally. But Newark's Regina Yarborough says it's tough to get New Jersey's 1.5 million single women to the polls.
Because I guess they've been let down through the Democratic Party for things that have happened in the past.
The Voter Participation Center says candidates need to work harder to get women's attention.
These are folks who have busy lives, and when you want to appeal to them, basically you have to appeal to them by speaking to things that are important in their lives.
President Obama pushed those issues hard this past weekend in a trip to Rhode Island and in his Saturday address, issues including equal pay, minimum wage, and child care.
More women are their family's main breadwinner than ever before. So the simple truth is, when women succeed, America succeeds. And we should be choosing policies that benefit women, because that benefits all of us.
Both Monmouth and Quinnipiac polls show that in New Jersey's Senate race, Democrat Cory Booker leads Republican Jeff Bell by more than 20 points among women voters. Bell probably did not help his chances when he said single mothers particularly are automatically Democratic because of the benefits. They need benefits to survive, and so that kind of weds them to the Democratic Party.
I don't think the comments are particularly helpful to women and to the Republican Party. As a single mother myself, the reason why I'm a Republican is because I think Republican policies offer a better opportunity for my children.
We don't mooch off the government. You can't judge and stereotype different people or a group of people just based on one opinion.
And people are still waiting. Some people still are holding on to hope. But I think he kind of holds on to empty dreams.
Women voters do hear these last-ditch appeals from President Obama and other Democrats. But analysts say they're suffering more from voter frustration than voter fatigue. In Newark, I'm Brenda Flanagan, NJTV News.
Play ball. That tops tonight's Garden State Express. Our first stop, Frankfurt, finally getting a baseball team. It's been 4 years since the Sussex Skyhawks skedaddled. Since then, the ballpark's changed owners, then had a $2 million renovation with luxury dining options and even skyboxes. The new owner says the new team will be playing in Skyland Park next spring. The team doesn't have a name yet or an affiliation with Major League Baseball. They'll play against the New Jersey Jackals at Yogi Berra Stadium in the Canadian American League. Next to Mansfield Township, where an off-duty state trooper collared some beef on the hoof. Trooper Dave Ortiz happened upon the critter named Buster, who'd apparently busted out of his confines on a Warren County farm. Though it's not clear that they teach herding livestock in the police academy, Ortiz helped his owner steer the steer back home. Finally, Cape May, where grape growers and oyster growers are contemplating joining forces to co-market their products. Cape May County's wineries want their own regional Cape May Peninsula brand. Connoisseurs call it an appellation. Cape May oysters also have a unique regional flavor. Foodies call it miroir. Imagine, tourists can be lured with wine tastings, watching oysters being prepared on the half shell, or eco-tourists could cart their claret to where the oysters grow along the mud flats at low tide. Both wine and oysters can be described as meaty or creamy with notes of chocolate, or robust yet insipid, and similar unassuming terms. A perfect pairing. And that's our Garden State Express for Tuesday, November 4th, 2014. Something up in your town? Tip us off.
Major funding for NJTV News provided in part by New Jersey Manufacturers, Auto Insurance and More for New Jersey Business and Industry Association members and their employees. New Jersey Association of Realtors, the voice for real estate in New Jersey. More information is online at njar.com. Verizon, communication solutions designed for the people and businesses of New Jersey. The members of the New Jersey Education Association, making public schools great for every child. Wells Fargo, together we'll go far. Horizon Blue Cross Blue Shield of New Jersey, an independent licensee of the Blue Cross and Blue Shield Association. The Star Ledger and NJ.com. Barnabas Health, life is better, healthy, online at barnabashealth.org. And PSENG, serving customers, strengthening the business community, and investing in New Jersey's future.
All this long election day, the Board of Elections poll watchers' job is to make sure every vote counts. They are the people who make democracy work. Who are they? Brianna Venosi reports.
Election day for Anne Marino of Montclair means a wake-up call before 4 a.m.
What motivates you to get up that early every election and come out here?
I honestly don't know, because every election I go, this is the last one. I've been saying that for 20 years.
Like most of the board workers at this Essex County polling site and around the state, she's a seasoned veteran.
And it's better because they know what they're doing. Because sometimes if you don't know what you're doing, you could throw everything out of whack. And the people are all really equipped, and they've been doing it long enough that they, I guess they could do it in their sleep.
Actually, close to 50 years ago, 45, 50 years ago, and I worked for about 10 years, and then, as I said, I went on to a career, and now that I'm retired, I'm back.
Essex County hires 2,500 workers for the November election, slightly less in June. They know the routine inside and out and keep it all running smoothly.
Well, they'll sign in, and then you give them a slip, and they go over there, they go in, and they vote. And, you know, someone sits there, and they click them in, and then they have to click themselves out so that their vote would be registered.
We get thanked a lot. People do come in, and they thank us for participating. Some people think we're volunteers. We actually do get paid.
$200 for the day. Essex County will spend a little over $500,000 for all board workers this cycle. The commitment is long, about 14 hours. But for the folks here, they believe it's part of their civic duty.
I believe you got to vote. That's what our soldiers are fighting for. You know, that's like that commercial says, home of the free because of the brave.
It was an opportunity to be involved in my community and to be able to participate in what goes on.
The requirements to be a board worker are fairly simple. You have to be a New Jersey resident, at least high school age, complete a brief training, and most importantly, you have to show up. Workers tend to skew a little older. They're more likely to have the flexibility in their schedules than their younger counterparts.
And I think when they think of the hours, doesn't exactly thrill them.
The State Division of Elections says they do have a steady stream of new applicants all the time, but these poll workers say they don't plan on giving up their spots just yet.
I see people come in who I don't normally see, and a lot of them I know from when my children were small, so it's kind of a mini reunion.
They say it's all worth it.
When I go home, the pillow looks like a piece of gold.
In Montclair, I'm Brianna Venosi, NJTV News.
Senior correspondent Mike Schneider and senior political correspondent Michael Aron are back with us. And we'd be remiss if we didn't wrap up with this election night talking about the Senate race. That was the most important thing to watch tonight nationally. The Republicans needed 6 seats to win control of the United States Senate so they would have control of both houses of Congress. Some political analysts are now saying they may have taken as many as 8 seats.
Yep. This was their stated goal. This was their mission. This puts them on their glide path for the presidential election a couple of years down the road. But it also, if it does turn out to be true, it also forces them to govern. And the Republicans will then have the House. They will then have the Senate. And they will then have to establish in the minds of the Americans that they're not just the party that says no to the president, they're the party that says This is how we can make things happen.
Might they also be able, though, to be the party who says, yeah, but the president's going to veto it?
That's where the rubber's going to meet the road in the next 2 years. Will they end up obstructing the president for two more years, or will they put bills on his desk, forcing him to veto them? Or maybe they can even negotiate some legislation on immigration. The other thing that's notable about this Senate going Republican that you referred to at the top of the broadcast is that here in New Jersey, our senior senator, Bob Menendez, loses his Foreign Relations Committee chairmanship. And there was even speculation in this studio over the weekend that he could enter the governor's race in 2017 if he were to get frustrated in the minority.
It's easier to get frustrated in the minority in the House, because once you lose your majority, you lose basically the ability to do anything. In the Senate, at least, one senator still can have that kind of clout to do a Mr. Smith goes to Washington thing on the floor. But the fascinating thing would be, if should Menendez decide, yes, I want to go down that road. Well, there's a lot of indications that Rush Holt might want to go down that road, too.
Yeah,
and there's a whole
up.
Bunch of other folks as well. That could get really crowded.
Cory Booker could even go down that road.
What a road.
But back to the issue of control, it doesn't necessarily mean that anything is going to get accomplished. We've had control of both houses by one party as recently as 2009, and gridlock still exists.
Let me posit this. There are those who argue that, for those who consider Bill Clinton to have been an effective president, that he became an effective president essentially after Newt Gingrich and company took control of Congress and forced him to move perhaps even more to the center, but to find a way to accommodate those whom he considered to be his political adversaries. And there are a great many who think that the prosperity of the 90s, to the extent that it existed, was a product of two types of different philosophies coming together to work.
Mike and Michael, thank you for being with us. As the final ballots are counted, we will tally up the official votes and bring full coverage to you tomorrow. I'm Mary Alice Williams. For all the men and women of NJTV News, thank you for being here. See you later.
Camden students face a lot of challenges, but they meet them with determination and drive.
Teachers like Ms. Harris make me feel like I'm part of a team, not just on a basketball court, but in a classroom.
Chanel is not just a star athlete, she is a star student.
I'm headed to Clemson University, where I can combine my love of sports and learning, and maybe even win a championship.
I wouldn't bet against her or any of my students reaching for their dreams.
Wells Fargo provides banking, insurance, investments, mortgage, and consumer and commercial finance through more than 300 stores and 445 ATMs throughout New Jersey.
Wells Fargo is committed to supporting New Jersey communities and charitable organizations focused on housing, community development, education, and many others that help strengthen the neighborhoods, towns, and cities where we live and work.
Wells Fargo. Together, we'll go far.